for coming together, and thank you for allowing us to share something with you. Vibhu Caitanya Prabhu will give us an update at 7 p.m. In terms of Maharaj's latest health situation, which seems to be very positive, moving in a very good direction. So we thought we'd just try to maybe share something, what our thoughts and feelings are. Of course, tomorrow, I don't know where everyone is geographically, but at least here in London, tomorrow is the beginning of Kartik. So maybe we could also reflect a little bit on that. And it will be very, very informal. So I guess I'll just try to say something for 20, 30 minutes, and then we'll open it up for any reflections or any discussion points that anyone would like to make, either based on what I share or anything you'd like to share. Omagyana timiranda sugyananjana shalakaya chakshurun militam yena tasmai shri gurave namaha vanchakalpatarubhyascha kripasindubhya evacha patitanam pavanebhyo vaishnavebhyo namo namaha Nama Om Vishnupadaya Krishna Prishthaya Bhutale Shrimate Bhakti Vedanta Swami Niti Namine Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschatyade Shatarine Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Shri Vaishadi Gaur Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama 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 Hare Hare. This week we were observing a very special day. On Tuesday it was the disappearance of three great acharyas, Raghunath Bhatta Goswami, Raghunath Das Goswami, and Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami, who were all residents of Vrindavan, who were all incredible renunciates, who were all completely sold out to Lord Chaitanya, and who all somehow or other disappeared on the same day, of course in different years, but it said they had such a bond of love amongst them that on the disappearance day of each other, it was too much and they left the world. And when we look at the lives of these three great acharyas, then we can actually learn many, many lessons. All of them ended up in Vrindavan, which already is very, very significant, because in the life of a devotee, we're all trying to go to Vrindavan. That's ultimately our destination. That's ultimately the place that we're trying to reach. Rupa Goswami gives us the nectar of instruction. And then after giving us all the different instructions in the Upadeshamrita, he says one instruction is the Upadesha Sar. It's the essence of all the nectarian instructions that I'm giving you. And what is that essential instruction in the nectar of instruction that he gives? He says, Tannama rupa charitadi sukirtananu shmrityo krameena rasana manasi niyojya, that one should somehow or other live such a naturally spontaneous Krishna conscious life that engagement in hearing about Krishna, speaking about Krishna, serving Krishna, such that everything around them becomes a stimulus for remembering Krishna. If one lives in this kind of consciousness, distan vraje tadanuragi jananugami, then that person is living in Vrindavan and in this way completely following in the footsteps of the Brajabasis. So for every devotee, all roads end in Vrindavan. That's the destination that we're trying to reach. That's the absorption that we're trying to grasp in our life. Of course, we remember our own spiritual master who's so much rooted in Vrindavan consciousness. And in that way, we're also aspiring for the same. Now, the interesting thing is that Raghunath Bhatta Goswami, Raghunath Das Goswami, and Krishna Das Kaviraj Goswami all ended up in Vrindavan, but they all ended up in Vrindavan in very different ways. Raghunath Das Goswami was running away from home. Sorry, this phone's going off. Raghunath Das Goswami was running away from home, such that Mahaprabhu told him, don't be a madman. Mahaprabhu gave him a cryptic message. Pada vyasinini nadi vyagrapi grihakarmashu. He said, just be like a lady at home who has a paramour lover. And in that way, do your duty very, very carefully, but internally be very much focused. Be very much focused on your ultimate object of love. Like this, Raghunath Das Goswami waited some time. Eventually, it became too much for him. He escaped from home. He got Nityananda's mercy, and then he ran to Mahaprabhu, and then Mahaprabhu told him to go to Vrindavan. And in that way, he ended up in Vrindavan by running away from home. Raghunath Bhatta Goswami, he was told by Mahaprabhu that you go back home and you care for your elderly parents until they've left from this world. And once you've wrapped up all of your duties, then you full-time engage in this life of renunciation. So he was a different kind of character. He was a different character. He was someone who fulfilled all his duties, completed his family life, and then went to Vrindavan. And Krishna Das Kaviraj Goswami, his story was completely different. He was just going about his business in his home, and one day Miniketana Ram came. He got offended by Gunaranava Mishra. And then Krishna Das Kaviraj Goswami was feeling very bad. And that night, Nityananda Prabhu came to him in a dream. And he said, Are Are Krishna Das Nakarah Bhai Vrindavana Yahataha Sarvalabhyahai. Oh, Krishna Das, don't worry about anything. Now you just go to Vrindavan and there you will gain everything that you require. So it's very interesting. All three of these sadhus, all three of these saints, all three of these acharyas ended up in Vrindavan, but they all had very, very different journeys. So that's the first lesson for us, that we all want to go to Vrindavan. We all want to be in Vrindavan. We all want to ultimately situate ourselves in Krishna's very own transcendental abode. But the way we reach there, the means by which we get there, the way we're going to do it, we're all going to be different, because we all come with a different life situation, a different karmic makeup, and a different set of obstacles and an artist to deal with. But the second very, very important instruction here is not just that we all have to end up in Vrindavan, which all three of these sadhus did, but if we want to end up in Vrindavan, then we have to follow the guidance of the guru. Because in each of their situations, their gurus gave them a very different route in order to get to Vrindavan, a very different set of instructions that would help them arrive at Krishna's abode. And in this way, the guru is the one who sets us the map, sets us on the journey. And in this way, they were all completely sold out. They were all ready to follow the orders of their gurus, however difficult the instructions were. It was difficult for Raghunath Das Goswami to not just run away straight away, but to go away and act like a pounds and shillings man, like Mahaprabhu told him, but he did it. It was difficult for Raghunath Bhatta Goswami to go back home and then fulfill all of his obligations and wait for everything to be tied up before coming to meet Mahaprabhu. But he did it. it was difficult for Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami, who just one night got a dream saying, go to Vrindavan the next morning. I mean, if we would get a dream like that, it would be quite difficult to just follow it. Like, just drop everything. Maybe some of us actually, we'd wish for a dream like that, maybe. But it would be difficult to just, in one go, just leave like that. But Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami did it. They say it's somewhat easy to follow the word of God, because you can read Krishna's words and then interpret it and follow it how you want to. So it's somewhat easy to follow the word of God, but it's much more difficult to follow the words of the devotees, because the devotees are very direct in how they're telling you to surrender, and there's not much room for movement there. So it takes much more of a surrender. But those who are able to follow the words of the Vaishnavas, the words of the Guru, the words of the sadhus, they are very much end up with a very clear map of how they're going to reach to Krishna's own divine abode. And so while remembering these three great personalities, we're remembering how much they were able to just embrace the path that was chalked out for them. Raghunath Das Goswami, while he was in Vrindavan, he was writing many, many amazing books. And one of his books he wrote was the Mukta Charita, which Kadamkan Maharaj often quotes and narrates the story of the pearl pastime. And in that beautiful book, Raghunath Das Goswami writes an invocatory mantra to the Guru. And the invocatory mantra to the Guru is very, very amazing that he writes, because in that mantra, he basically begins to explain every gift that the Guru is giving the disciple in order to allow the disciple to enter into the pastimes of Radha and Krishna. And the Guru, what he's expertly doing is building up the spiritual wealth, the spiritual connection of the disciple in different ways, so that in order for that disciple to then enter into the divine abode will become a seamless transition. So what is that network? What are those connections? What is that spiritual wealth that the Guru is developing within the disciple? Raghunath Das Goswami explains. He says in the first line, Nama Shrestham Manumapi Sachiputram Atra Swarupam. He says, the first thing that the Guru gave me is connection with Nam, the holy name of Krishna. Nama Shrestham. The first thing that the Guru gave me was connection with Nam. The second thing the Guru gave me, Sachiputram. He gave me connection with Mahaprabhu. He gave me connection with the son of Sachidevi. And then what's the third thing the Guru gave me? Atra Swarupam Rupam Dasya Grajam. He gave me connection to the Acharyas, specifically Swarup Damada, Rupa Goswami, and the other Goswamis of Vrindavan. So the third thing he gave me was connection to the Acharyas. And then what's the fourth thing he gave me? Urupurim Mathurim Gostavatim Radha Kundam Girivaram. The fourth thing he gave me was connection to Mathura, connection to Govardhan, and connection to Radhakund, and ultimately connection to the divine abode known as Vrindavan. And then he says, Radha Kundam Girivaram, Aharadika Madhavasam. And by having these four connections, he's ultimately giving me connection into the eternal pastimes which are going on between Radha and Krishna. So this is the job description of a guru. A guru is meant to give you connection to Nam. He's meant to give you connection to Mahaprabhu. He's meant to give you connection to the Acharyas, and he's meant to give you connection to Vrindavan. And then ultimately, by giving connection with all of these things, then ultimately, Aharadika Madhavasam, he'll give you entrance into the pastimes of Radhika and Madhava. So Prabhupada gave us all of these things. And then what the expert followers of Prabhupada do is they nourish us, they train us, they coach us, they inspire us. And through their own example, they basically guide us in terms of how we can then develop more and more of a substantial connection with all of these things. And so if we ever come across a personality in our life who helps us to develop our spiritual connection with these things, we can understand this person is truly guru. And I'm sure all of us can relate to how our own spiritual master has so much nourished our connection with all of these things, with the holy name. You know, how much Maharaj has, you know, first and foremost through his own taste in the holy name and his own absorption, and then through his deep reflections and his constant personal guidance. I remember some years ago, Maharaj started this thing called Japa Talks on his website. And he'd ask all the devotees to like write their reflections about Japa. And somehow or other, I didn't write anything on there. And then Maharaj came to me and he said, "You have no realizations of the holy name. That's why you're not writing it. Well, you need to think about the holy name and then write something on that forum. Devotees need to think about the holy name." So Maharaj so much is like encouraging us to understand the Nam Tattva in a deeper way. And then Sachiputram, how much Mahaprabhu connects us to Gauranga, to Chaitanya. I remember once I said to Maharaj that, "Maharaj, I can't get into Gura Leela. It's like, it's difficult. I don't quite understand it. It's like, it's beyond me." And then he looked at me and he said, "Think about Gura Leela later. First understand Gura Tattva. First understand the truth about Gauranga. First understand the position of Gauranga." And then he said to me that, "If you have a connection with me, you have to have a connection with Gauranga. There's no way you can be my disciple and not have a connection with Gauranga." So how much Maharaj connects us to Gauranga, to Mahaprabhu, to Chaitanya Charitamrita. And not just that, the mood of Gauranga, the magnanimity, the compassion, the sense of just freely giving without any consideration of who's qualified, who's not. Just that very deep mood of kindness that Gauranga embodies, Mahaprabhu embodies, Maharaj really communicates that to each one of us. And then, yes, the acharyas, you know, Maharaj often talks about the Goswamis, and he talks about that letter where Prabhupada says, I want to have 25 renunciates in Vrindavan who are just like the Goswamis, so that we can push on our movement in this way. So Maharaj, so much connected to the Goswamis, so much connected to the acharyas, so much connected to the commentaries and the things that they've written and the insights that they've had. Many of us have had the fortune traveling with Maharaj and going to many of these places and hearing Maharaj's reflections on all of these things, like this, like nurturing us in having a deeper relationship with the acharyas, not just the informational relationship with the acharyas, but a very meaningful personal relationship with the acharyas. Maharaj really brings that out, you know, how he brings out the personality of each acharya so amazingly. And in this way, he's kind of training us in how to very much have a personal connection with all the amazing personalities in our movement. I remember some of us on this call, we remember we went to Bangladesh with Maharaj. And one of the places we went to in Bangladesh was Sylhet, which is the original place where Advaita Acharya advented himself. So we went to this place. For anyone who came on that trip, you might remember it was like out in the sticks. It was like so difficult to get there. It's like, you know, such an endeavor. And then somehow we got there, and at least for the superficial eye, there was nothing much there. There was a kind of small temple. There wasn't anything that much. And when we were coming back, I was like, Maharaj, that was quite an endeavor to get there. You know, there wasn't like so much. There wasn't so much to see there, Maharaj. And then he didn't say much at that time. And then what happened is the next morning we arrived in Mayapur, and then we were in the Panchatattva temple. So I was there. I didn't realize Maharaj was there. So I was there in front of Panchatattva at Darshanarti, and I was praying. And you know what it's like. You pray to Mahaprabhu, and then you pray to Nityananda. And then I was praying to Advaita, and just as I prayed to Advaita Acharya, whose place we had gone to the previous day, just as I was praying to Advaita Acharya, Maharaj came behind me and he whispered in my ear. He said, "Now it's different when you see Advaita Acharya, isn't it? Because you've been to his birthplace, because you made the endeavor to try and understand him in a deeper way, because we made the yatra, the pilgrimage to that place, now when you see Advaita Acharya, it's different, isn't it?" And so that was very nice, because I realized that's what the guru does. He helps you to have a much more personal connection with all of the personalities within our wonderful spiritual family. And then the guru connects you to Vrindavan. And I don't think any of us need to be told that. It's very, very clear. So many of the devotees here have been with Maharaj on parikrama to Vrindavan. And Maharaj holds Vrindavan so much within his heart. And Maharaj is really... really encourages that within each one of us to understand that yes, we worship Krishna, but specifically we worship Krishna in Vrindavan, and understanding what the spirit, what the mood, what the underlying essence of Vrindavan is. And Maharaj really brings that out. And because he spent so many years in Vrindavan, not just in Vrindavan, but serving in Vrindavan, he's so much filled with that spirit. So that's why I was just kind of reflecting on today about how all these three great acharyas ended up in Vrindavan by the mercy of their spiritual teachers. They all had very different journeys, and their spiritual teachers knew what journey to take them on. And they were surrendered to their spiritual teachers, and thus they made that journey. And Raghunath Das Goswami is then explaining to us how the guru helps to introduce you to the entire pastimes of Radha and Krishna by introducing you to all this spiritual wealth, the holy name, Mahaprabhu, Vrindavan, the acharyas. And so like Kartik is, I don't know where you are, but in London, Kartik begins tomorrow. And so, like, I was just thinking that this is what we do in Kartik. We take all of these gifts that the spiritual master has given, and we really then try to go deep with that. We try to make it more meaningful. We try to really establish a significant, powerful connection with these things. And we try to intensify it. If we were in Vrindavan today, then we would be doing Vrindavan Parikrama. Tomorrow we would be beginning Vrindavan Parikrama. And when some Parikrama parties begin doing Parikrama in Vrindavan, then the first place they go to is Dvadasaditya Til. So if you know, like when you come out of Krishna Balaram temple and then you go right and then you go right again and then you start coming down the Parikrama mark, then you go past like Kaliya Ghat, where Krishna chastised Kaliya demon. And then you go further, and then you come to Madan Mohan temple. And Madan Mohan temple is situated atop Dvadasaditya hill. And what happened is that when Krishna jumped into the Yamuna to subdue the Kaliya demon, and then finally bestowed his mercy by not annihilating Kaliya, when Krishna came out and jumped back onto land, he jumped back onto this hill. But because Krishna had gone into the Yamuna and he was still wet, he was kind of shivering a little bit. So it said that the one sun that was shining above the hill expanded into 12 suns. And therefore it's called Dwadasaditya Hill, the hill of 12 suns, because the one sun transformed into 12 suns. And atop that hill is the Madan Mohan temple. And Madan Mohan is said to be the deity which is in charge of Sambandha. So in the beginning of spiritual life, we're very much praying to Madan Mohan. Jayatam suratur pangor mama mandam ater gati. That I'm ill, I'm lame and ill-advised, and so much overcome by lust that I'm praying for your mercy, that I can overcome my lust and thus become determinedly engaged in devotional service. So it said that when you begin parikrama, this is the first place you come to. You come to this place first, because first you take the permission of Madan Mohan, who's the Sambandha Vigraha, because Madan Mohan is helping us to overcome lust. There's no chance of seeing Vrindavan if one is still having lust within the heart. That's why you begin your parikrama there. But it's also said there's another reason why you begin your parikrama there, because on the hill where the one sun expanded into 12, so the sun was 12 times more intense. The pilgrim goes to Vrindavan, the pilgrim who's beginning parikrama, goes to that place and prays to Krishna that on this parikrama, in this month of Kartik, allow my bhajan, allow my spiritual practice, allow my sadhana and my vows to become 12 times more intense. And in this way, allow me to really make some significant spiritual advancement. So these are some things that I thought I wanted to share with everyone about Guru, about Vrindavan, about the gifts that the Guru gives to each one of us, and about how in this month of Kartik that's coming up, how it's really just an opportunity to intensify our connection with all of these gifts and in this way live a very natural, spontaneous, inspired spiritual life. Because I think if there's one message that Maharaj gives again and again, it's about living an inspired spiritual life. Yes, there is duty. Yes, there is determination. Yes, there are rules and regulations and rituals. Yes, all of these things are required, but ultimately it's a movement of taste. It's a movement of inspiration. It's a movement which is based on actual experience of genuine Krishna consciousness. And so I think Kartik is really that time in which we can take all of these things that our spiritual master has given us and really take advantage of it and really try to implant it deep within our hearts. Okay, I guess I don't want to speak too much more than that. It would be really nice. There are many, many devotees on the call, many, many senior other disciples also. It would be nice to hear anyone's reflections on any of these points, or if you have any discussion points, then we can discuss that. So, yes. Would anyone like to share anything, or if anyone has any question they would like to ask, please also share your feelings or recollections of Maharaj in relation to maybe any of these points about the gifts that the Guru gives us like that.
Yes, I would like to say something.
Yes, Bhagavati, Hare Krishna. Thank you.
Well, especially with regards to the that spiritual master gives us Lord Caitanya. Because I actually had, you told Guru Maharaj that you had a hard time having that relationship with Lord Caitanya, and I always struggled with that. And when Guru Maharaj was in Radhadesh before he went to Germany, I asked him if I could help him with his book. And I got this project from him, and it involved me going through all the books of the Goswamis and the Caitanya Charitamrita, finding all the Srimad Bhagavatam verses. And it actually really made me, it forced me to go really deep and to understand not only Lord Caitanya, but all those wonderful devotees and the philosophy and the links between it. And then at the same time, obviously, we had all the lectures that he gave every day, which were right next to my room. I was staying right next to him. So it gave me a lot of appreciation, especially for that part, because I knew that he was my link to Lord Caitanya, but this time I could really see it in practice. And it was an amazing experience.
Thank you so much for sharing that. Yeah, I think Maharaj is so expert at engaging us in services, and often we think like it's a great opportunity to serve Maharaj, and of course whatever service we can do, but there's always a deeper thing within it where he's actually giving us the greatest gift by engaging us in that. It's kind of like Krishna sends Uddhava to Vrindavan and he's like, can you do me a favor and just send this message to the gopis to kind of tell them that don't worry, I'll be back soon. And Uddhava's thinking like, yeah, I've got this really great responsible service to do for Krishna. And then he arrives in Vrindavan and realizes that, oh my God, I don't have the devotion that the Brajavasis have. And actually Krishna sent me here so I can learn something. In the service for Maharaj, he actually teaches us something that we need to learn. So yeah, I think many of us have that experience. Thank you very much. And just to share something else on Lord Caitanya, I think Antaranga Prabhu was doing some service for Maharaj, and Maharaj was getting him to read the Caitanya Mangal. And in the Caitanya Mangal, it says that in the future, Vyasadeva will come again. Vyas will come again and tell more of the pastimes of Mahaprabhu. And so that was a little bit puzzling, because it's like, what, does Vyas come again to like tell the pastimes of Mahaprabhu? Like, what does this mean? But then when you look in the Antya Leela chapter 20 of the CC, then Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur Prabhupada quotes in the purport, he explains that what this means is that in the future, many spiritual masters who are perfectly in the line of Vyasadeva will come to explain Mahaprabhu's pastimes, and those spiritual masters are to be also called Vyas because they're perfect representatives of Vyas. And therefore those spiritual masters who are perfectly in the line of Vyasadeva will tell the pastimes of Mahaprabhu, and they should be known as Vyas. And on their birthday, we do a Vyasa Puja like that. So that also reminded us of Maharaj, that he's very much in that line, sharing those pastimes of Mahaprabhu and connecting us. Thank you very much. I don't know if anyone else would like to
share. There's one question in the chat from Achyuta Gotra Prabhu. He says, when Maharaj said first understand Gaura Tattva, would you advise that we should first understand Guru Tattva?
Yeah. So when we read the Chaitanya Charitamrita, then we'll see that the first 14 verses of the Adi Leela chapter 1 are a Mangalacharan to the whole book of the Chaitanya Charitamrita. And those 14 verses are expanded into 12 chapters. And those first 12 chapters of the Adi Leela are very much all about Gaura Tattva, about Guru Tattva, and about basically all aspects of philosophy that's required in order to then really enter into Mahaprabhu's pastimes. So yes, understanding Guru Tattva, Gaura Tattva, these are all synonymous points. And actually, if we read Prabhupada's book systematically, then we'll see that Prabhupada perfectly takes us on that journey. So like if you just read Chaitanya Charitamrita systematically from the beginning, chapter one, Adi Leela, then you'll understand Gaura Tattva, you'll understand Guru Tattva. Because right in the beginning of Chaitanya Charitamrita, Kaviraj Goswami says, Vande Gurun, Isha Bhaktan, Isha Nisha Vatarakan. He's saying that I have many gurus, and he's explaining about all his different gurus. He's explaining about who Gauranga is. He's explaining about all the different tattvas and shaktis of Krishna. And so all of this is covered within those chapters. So yes, Guru Tattva, Gaura Tattva, and even Krishna Tattva must be understood before anything else. And that was Mahaprabhu's instructions to the Goswamis. That his first instructions to the Goswamis was Bhakta Bhakti Krishna Prem Tattvera Nidhar. Understand, document the tattva of the devotee, the tattva of the Lord, and the tattva of devotional service. All of these truths, outline them in all the scriptures, because this is the foundation of everything. We will not understand anything more if the philosophy is not there. Therefore, in Chaitanya Charitamrita, it's explained, Siddhanta boliye chite nakara alash. When it comes to talking about Siddhanta, discussing philosophy, understanding tattva, nakara alash, don't be lazy. Why? Iha hoite Krishna lage sudrida manush. Because when you do that, hard philosophical work of trying to grasp the Siddhanta, then your mind becomes very, very strong and very, very steady and very, very controlled. And one who doesn't have a strong, steady, controlled mind will not be able to enter into the mysteries of Krishna's understanding. So yeah, I hope that helps. Would anyone else like to ask any questions or?
Sutapa Prabhu?
Yes.
Krishna Kirtan here. Hari Bol Prabhu. Thank you for your presentation so far. It's been very inspiring. You touched on two themes on Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and also the Kartik Vrindavan mood. Wait. How can you guide us in how we see? The question is that we very much attach to Vrindavan, but then we're also supposed to be attached to Sri Chaitanya. And it's not that we draw a line, Vrindavan is Radha Krishna, and we're supposed to think of Mayapur Mahaprabhu. It's not like that. How can we better understand how we approach Kartik, which is a month where we very much focus on Krishna in Vrindavan, but we see it with this appreciation and through the worship of Gauranga. Does that make sense, my question?
Yeah, I'll say some things and then if I don't.
Thank you.
Narottam says, Sri Krishna Chaitanya, Radha Krishna Nahi Anya. There's no entrance to Radha and Krishna unless you go through Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So that we know. We know that Vrindavan is the place of Raganuga Bhakti. So then sometimes people say, like, you're not going to do it through sadhana. You need to achieve Raganuga Bhakti. But it said that the Sankirtan movement, Mahaprabhu came to give that process by which one can enter into that very spontaneous loving attraction with Krishna. And so we're going through Mahaprabhu. Now the thing is, there's no difference between Navadvip and between Mayapur and Vrindavan. Like it says that even in one bhajan, that one should not see that they're any different. Mahaprabhu himself wanted to go to Vrindavan, right? Like he had many aspirations to go to Vrindavan after first initiation, Harinam initiation, after sannyas, after meeting Rupa and Sanatan. 3 or 4 times he was foiled in his attempts to go to Vrindavan. But eventually he reached Vrindavan and he did his Rajamandal Parikrama. So in Krishna consciousness, everything is connected. Mahaprabhu is connected to Vrindavan. Mahaprabhu came to Vrindavan. Mahaprabhu was under the tamarind tree at Imlital, isn't it? Krishna was under that tree and Krishna was Shyam and he was thinking of Radharani. And therefore under that tamarind tree at Imlitala, Krishna became golden thinking of Radharani. And that same Imlitala, that same tamarind tree, Mahaprabhu, who was Gaura, was thinking of Krishna in the mood of Radharani, and that Gauranga became Shyam. So that Mahaprabhu came to Vrindavan. Mahaprabhu sent his followers to Vrindavan, the Goswamis. So I think when we think of Mahaprabhu, we can't separate it from Vrindavan, because Mahaprabhu, when he was in Jagannath Puri, he was only thinking of, he was seeing Chatak Parvat and thinking of Govardhan Hill. He was seeing Jagannath Ocean and thinking of the Yamuna. He was, he was seeing Jagannath and thinking of Krishna with a flute in Vrindavan. All of these things are there. So Mahaprabhu is in Vrindavan consciousness. So it all fits together, actually. It all fits. When you increase your love for Mahaprabhu, you increase your love for Vrindavan. When you increase your love for Mahaprabhu, you naturally gain access to Radha and Krishna. And through the Sankirtan of the holy names, ultimately, because even Radharani is said, isn't it? Raghunath Das Goswami says in one song, Ekada Krishna Virahad Dhyayanti Priya Sangamam. Ekada Krishna Virahad, Radharani Ekada, one day, Krishna Virahad, she was feeling great separation from Krishna. Dhyayanti Priya Sangamam, and she was meditating on her beloved again and again, thinking, when will I meet him? Mano Bashpa Nirasaya, then in order to alleviate the discomfort within her mind at being separated from Krishna, Japanditam Muhur Muhur. Again and again, she began chanting Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. So Raghunath Das Goswami writes this in a song of how Radharani was one day feeling great separation from Krishna and began chanting the Maha Mantra in order to relieve her separation. So like this, we see Mahaprabhu, his inner desire, the process that he gave, is very much connecting you to Vrindavan. And therefore, when one sees all of these things in a deeper way, then there's no sense of separation because everything transcendentally synergizes. I don't know if that answers.
Yeah, that's a nice point. And just something else that came to my mind was how Maharaj introduced this idea of the Prabhupada gate, how we enter Vrindavan practically through that gate, but symbolically also by Prabhupada's mercy. Maybe you can just explain that a bit more as well.
Yeah, entering Vrindavan. And then also Gopali on the message says that I mentioned we should go Madan Mohan first. You're saying we should come through Prabhupada's gate first. And Guru Maharaj also said you should go to Gopeshwar Mahadev first because he's the protector of the Dham. So where should we go first? There's a transcendental dilemma here. Well, I think they're all correct. Maharaj does say we come through the Prabhupada gate. It's Prabhupada who was the ambassador of Vrindavan. It's Prabhupada that left Vrindavan and invited the whole world back. Once when I was going on a Vrajamandal Parikrama, the day before I left, I called Sachinandan Maharaj and he told me the first thing I should do when I go to Vrindavan is go to Prabhupada's Samadhi and take Prabhupada's blessings. So there's definitely a case for that. There's definitely a case for going to Madan Mohan, because Madan Mohan is a Sambandha Vigraha, and that is a Vrindavan tradition to go there first on Parikrama. And as Gopali is saying, there is also a case for going to Gopeshwar Mahadev, because ultimately he's the protector of the Dham, and without his permission, one can have all the arrangements made, but they will never really see Vrindavan. So I think it's one of those transcendental things where they're all right. Maybe you need to expand yourself in three bodies and go simultaneously to all of them. Hare Krishna. If anyone else, by the way, has any reflection on this, then please feel free to share. Sadbhuj Prabhu, you're on my screen. Would you like to say something?
I'm on your screen. Oh my God.
Yeah, you're spotlighted.
Okay. Yeah. Very nice what you're talking, and I'm very appreciated. Very deep thoughts. And for me, like, really, to see practically how, okay, that's the theory, but ultimately it has to reach our heart. And then as well, it needs devotees who are reaching our heart and also who are giving us access to Vrindavan. And I mean, for us all, okay, we can go to Gopeshwar Mahadev, we can go through the gate, but still it's just like, you know, it's not the same experience as if Maharaj is guiding us through that places and staying like 2-3 hours in one place and doing the kirtan, because then really we can experience that area to the more deeper, you know, level. And he's telling the stories and stuff. And so there we can see, like, very practical how it's applied. And by the application, it's just reaching our heart. And that's then really what stays during our life. And I think it doesn't matter where we go, but with Maharaj, we will get the access. But definitely on our own, we can go to all these places and remember like these experiences, and in this way get the access to the holy place and get all the memories up and all the inspiration. And that can lead us through the whole year, no? Like, even now when I do kirtan of my, I think of Vrindavan and go to these places.
Thank you, Sadhguru Prabhu, for sharing. Yeah, it's the Vaishnavas that give us access. The Vaishnava is said to be a receptacle of bhava, overflowing with spiritual emotion. And anyone who comes in the vicinity of such a Vaishnava, even if they're not qualified, then they can begin to experience some of that emotion that the Vaishnava is experiencing all the time. And therefore, to stay close to the Vaishnavas and then visit the Dham, that's the real visit of a Dham. Because Prabhupada also used to quote the famous verse that, Yatirta buddhi shalilena karhichit janeshva bigyeshu sa eva gokara. Prabhupada used to quote this verse a lot. He said that if one goes to a holy place and simply bathes in the rivers, simply visits the holy sites, janeshva bigyeshu, but he does not go to meet, or he does not hear from those who actually have really connected to those places in a deep way, sa eva gokara, then he's said to be as good as a cow or an ass. So that Prabhupada often said. And it's interesting, in Vraja, there's a place called Kosi. And when Prabhupada went on Vraja Mandal Parikrama with Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur, then all the devotees came to Kosi. And in the morning, Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur was giving a lecture, and like half the crowd must have been missing. And he asked, like, where is everyone? And they said, well, they've gone to see some places. But Prabhupada had stayed there. Prabhupada had stayed there to be close to his spiritual master, to hear from him. And Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur very much appreciated that. He said he likes to hear. And because of his habit, because of his tendency to hear, sitting at the feet of the spiritual master, everything will come. And therefore, yeah, I really appreciate your point that we don't have that kind of quality. It can sound very nice and romantic. I'll go to Vrindavan and I'll see it and it will be amazing and it will sound. But unless we're with devotees who are deeply experiencing that, neither will it be deep nor will it be sustained meditation that we have. So yeah, thank you, Sadbhuj, for sharing that. Would anyone else like to share anything? Or
Hare Krishna, Sutapa Prabhu, this is Yogesh here. How are you? Wonderful to see you. It's great news. The progress is fantastic. Thank you for sharing all those good news this morning. Whoever has been doing that, wonderful. Maharaj described Jaipur as our city, the Gaudiya city, for the Vaishnavas. Of course, some of the original deities like Madan Mohan, so they are in Rajasthan, right? So what is the significance of Rajasthan, and Jaipur in particular, sort of deceased, is that when you say we should visit Madan Mohan, is that the place in Rajasthan we should visit? Or
the immediate reason why the deities were taken there is that they were very powerful rulers in those places, and so those places were not as vulnerable in terms of Muslim invasion and other things, and so they were a safe place for the deities to be because they would be protected there, free from any of these upheavals. And therefore we see, yes, Radha Damodar and Radha Govinda, they were all moved to these places. So we should go to these places. Even in Vrindavan tradition, it's said that if one wants to have the full darshan of Krishna, you see the three deities, Madan Mohan, Govinda, and Gopinath. It said that when Krishna's grandson, Vajranab, crafted many deities in order to ensure the worship of Krishna for many generations, then when he wanted to craft the deities, then he took guidance from Uttara, because Uttara, if you remember, saw Krishna, especially at the end of the Mahabharata war, when Ashwatthama released the Brahmastra to kill Parikshit, then Uttara was praying to Krishna. So Uttara saw Krishna. So Vajranab went to Uttara and said, can you describe Krishna to me? Because I need to make some deities of Krishna so that for the future generations, they will worship Krishna like that. So he said, when Vajranab crafted the Madan Mohan deity, then it was exactly like Krishna, but from the navel down. Then when Vajranab crafted the Gopinath deity, then it said from the navel up to the neck, it was exactly like Krishna. And when Vajranab crafted the Govindaji, then it said from the neck upwards, the face was exactly like Krishna. And so according to Vrindavan tradition, if you want to have the full darshan of Krishna, then you need to see Madan Mohan, Gopinath, and Govinda all in the same day. And even today you can do it. You can drive from Vrindavan to Jaipur and then stop at Karali and do it all in one day and get the full darshan of Krishna. So yes, it's... In Chaitanya Charitamrita, Kaviraj Goswami writes that these three deities are the life and soul of the Gaudiya Vaishnavas. And so Jaipur, because they are home to those deities, is very much a Vaishnav place.
Thank you.
Thank you, Hare Krishna. So I think it's 7 o'clock.
There's just one more question from Mother Sanatani. And then we can ask Vibhu to speak. Can you please mention something about online Vrindavan Parikram that starts with you tomorrow, if it's still possible for others to join? Most of us are missing Vrindavan now.
Oh, yes. Okay, so I'll put a link. If any of you are interested, we're doing like an online parikrama. How can I say? It will not come anywhere close to replacing your experiences of going on parikrama with Maharaj, but maybe some transcendental thoughts and transcendental stimuli of stories will come to you, which will help you to remember all those times with Maharaj. So I'll later on in this call, I'll put a link in the WhatsApp group, and if anyone wants to join, you are more than welcome. There'll be some videos every day, and Dhammarashtakam kirtans and other things. So yeah, you're all welcome. So thank you very much. Apologies for my shortcomings. Apologies for anything I may have said wrong. Very wonderful to have all of your association. And let's all pray that Maharaj gets back to 100% very, very soon. All glories to His Holiness Kadamba Kanana Maharaj ki jai. Srila Prabhupada ki jai.
Jai.
Ki jai.
Thank you very much, Sutapa Prabhu. So now we'll hand over to His Grace Vibhu Caitanya Prabhu, who will give us an update.
Hey, Gashyam. Mancha Kalpa Trivyascha Kripa Sinavayacha Patitanam Pavnaviyo Vaishnaviyo Namo Namo. Hey, Gashyam. So thank you, Sutapa Prabhu, for that inspiring talk. And thank you, Gokulesh Prabhu, for arranging today's meeting. This whole week has brought back so much of memories, and it feels like deja vu once again, you know. For those who don't know, we had quite a scare in 2016 when we found out that Maharaj had cancer, and it really scared us, you know, where doctors in India were saying that what Maharaj has is really fatal, and if he does the surgery, it's not going to really work out so nicely and things like that. And with that, Maharaj immediately flew to South Africa, where he was in touch with the doctors who are usually treating him here, Dr. Sunil Mohan and his whole team. And we went through operation after operation. Maharaj had two operations at those times. And when we came out of the first operation, we were thinking, Jai, the doctor said it's all clear. We managed to take out all the cancer and it's all looking good, you know. And the next day, I heard the doctors discussing in the corridor. So I went and heard their conversation, and they were saying, it doesn't look good. It doesn't look good. There's still cancer in the body, and we'll have to go back and do another procedure. So I was thinking, and they were telling me, don't tell the Swami just as yet, you know. And what did I do? I immediately went and told the Swami. I immediately went to Maharaj and said, Maharaj, this is what the doctors are discussing right now. He says, yes, this is what I've learned in this material world, that whenever, we should never be happy or sad, you know. We should always just stay neutral. Always just stay neutral. And this is always Maharaj's mood. We stay neutral. And from there, we learned a lot. We went through all these procedures, and Maharaj has been checking himself every single year in the beginning of the year for doing all these scans, doing blood tests, and et cetera. And until today, we're so happy to announce that, yes, Maharaj doesn't have cancer. So when this whole thing came up again this week on Wednesday, was it? It just brought all these memories back, and I'm thinking, oh, are we going to go through this again? But I'm really happy to report that Maharaj was struggling so much with being fatigued. He was feeling symptoms last weekend. He had a high fever last weekend, so he tested on Monday. The results came back on the 27th on Tuesday. It was really late in the night, and then the news broke out on Wednesday morning that Maharaj tested positive. Maharaj, if he could be, he could be a doctor as well. He's really expert in managing these things. So he's all his vitals at the moment are really good. His temperature is okay. His blood saturation levels are all normal. His pressure is okay. Sore throat is no longer there. And he's feeling good, but only thing he's feeling a little exhausted. But today he had a little more energy than he had yesterday. So as Maharaj said earlier today, things are looking very well. It's on the up now. So thanks to all the devotees for all your kind prayers and sacrifice that you've been making over the last few days. So let's just continue, and I think it's all going to be okay. So I don't think there's any need to give us to give daily updates anymore. We'll try our best, but as we said, there's no need to cause any alarm at the moment, because Maharaj is feeling perfectly fine at the moment, just dealing with the exhaustion. We also know that the farm in Simachalam, they currently are in a strict quarantine, and that will go on until the 5th of November. So nobody is allowed to go in or out at the moment. And there's a few other devotees that are infected as well with the coronavirus. Also, we like to thank the devotees in Germany, Gaur Mahan Prabhu, the temple president there, and his team for taking such good care of Maharaj. So that's where we're standing at the moment. Does anyone have any questions or concerns?
There was a question from Mother Merumala about whether Maharaj's medical costs are covered or whether some assistance is required with that.
Sure, for now it is all covered. There's no cost that incurred at the moment. There was just these pressure monitors and blood oximeters that we needed to, pulse oximeters that we needed to purchase, but the devotees and the farm purchased them. So we all covered at the moment.
Vibhu, Caitanya Prabhu.
Yes. Yes.
For next Friday, shall we just keep it in the diary? And if it's Maharaj, then it's Maharaj. And if it's not, then one of you.
I'm almost certain that it's going to be Maharaj. So, yeah, it should stand.
Doesn't okay, seem to be any other questions. So thank you very much, Vibhu Caitanya Prabhu, and thank you for the daily updates and for calming and soothing the hearts of the devotees. Well, it was, you know, very agitated hearing this about Maharaj. But thank you for your care that you've shown to all of us. And we really appreciate it very much.
Thank you, Hal. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. So now we'll invite Sadbhuja Prabhu. Sadbhuja Prabhu, you can lead us in some kirtan.
Yes, it's my honor to be part of this amazing Sangha. And thank you so much for this update, and also Sutapa for your wonderful words. I would like to do a kirtan now. And my idea is, Maharaj, so many years he is exhausting himself so much with us, giving so much energy to us and inspiring us. So my idea is now in this kirtan that we send a lot of love and energy to Maharaj, so his deep exhaustion over the years can heal, not just the short-term health issues, but like he can really feel that we are giving something back to him with this kirtan in general also, of course. And yeah, so I would like you all to join. And you can take out your instruments at home and sing very loudly. Maybe I take out the...
This would be better by the sound. It's a melody Maharaj sang in Mayapur when we had the disciple meeting there. I'm remembering this meeting often when I sing this melody.
Namo Vishnu Padaya, Krishna Vishnaya. Swami Krishna 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 Bhakti Swami Namaste Saraswati Devani Prajani Vishesha Shunyavari Vashajare Shatari Namaste Saraswati Devani Prajani
Hare Rama,
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Hare, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Krishna Krishna, Hare Rama, Hare Krishna, Krishna Hare Rama, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare 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 Rama, Rama Rama, Hare
Jai Jai. Yeah. If someone of you likes to organize a 24 or 12 hour bhajan online, you're most welcome. I would join, but I'm not. But it's very nice to have all your association here, at least online. Very inspiring for me.
Thank you very much, Sadbhuja. Thank you for that wonderful kirtan. Wonderful to see you. And thank you for sharing your practical realization of entering into Vrindavan as well. I very much appreciated that. And we're looking forward to being with Maharaj in the Dham once again, in the Sangha of all you wonderful Vaishnavas. So thank you, devotees, for joining. And like Vibhu Caitanya Prabhu said, we're hopeful that next week we'll be in Gurudev's association once again online. So please, all of you, join, and we'll see you all again next week. Thank you so much. Hare Krishna.
Thank you. Thank you. Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna. Thank you for organizing this.